Can everyone hear?
Yep.
Everyone that wants to hear, I guess. Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Nice to have you with us this morning. Really pleased that God manipulated the weather for us so that we could have a nice, somewhat cool, maybe humid day. So thanks for joining us outside. It's nice to see some new and some strange faces here today. And of course, we have visitors as well, so thank you for coming. Our call to worship this morning comes from Psalm 98. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm have worked salvation for him. The Lord has made known in his salvation. He has revealed his righteousness in the sight of the nations. He has remembered his steadfast love and faithfulness to the house of Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our God. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Break forth into joyous song and sing praises. Will you please stand and join us? And I think you have words in your hymnal there. Come, now is the time to worship, followed by Amazing Grace.
Yours aren't either. Thank you. across 18 that our chains are gone, because they are gone. We've been set free.
Ushers, come forward for this morning's offering.
Thank you.
Father, we do thank you for this day. We thank you for the opportunity to be outside and ingest the beauty and enjoy the beauty and the majesty of your creation. We thank you for the sun. We thank you for the shade. We thank you for the coolness of the day. And we thank you for brothers and sisters in Christ who can gather together to worship and adore your holy name. Lord, we do thank you for the many gifts that you've given us. We thank you for the way that you have provided so generously for us and how you have taken care of each and every one of us. Lord, we know that there are those with pains and aches and different things that they're battling and struggling with. And Lord, we just do pray for each and every one of them. And Lord, we just ask that you would continue to bless us and guide us as a church, Lord, that we would be one who care about the lost, who care about those who don't yet know you. So Lord, we ask that you would bless us as we offer you our giving as an act of worship. We pray that you would use and multiply these gifts, that they might be used to building and establishing your kingdom. And Lord, we pray that you would use the good people of Lakeside Church to reach the lost. Lord, we ask you to bless those who have to give and those who have not to give. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, we don't have any music unless somebody wants to come up and hum something.
Get up and
hum something. So I might as well just do a couple of announcements, I guess. One, you're welcome to join us on our Wednesday night Bible study at 6 o'clock. I think this past week there were... Is that fireworks?
No, it's wind.
Wind?
It's picking up the wind.
Oh. Through this. All right. But you're welcome to join us on Wednesday nights. And we've been talking about the message and also how we can be better at doing evangelism and reaching the lost. So you're welcome to join us at 6 o'clock. We do usually finish around 7 or so. So you're welcome to join us for that. Also, Christy's Wednesday night Bible study, or Thursday morning Bible study. You're welcome to join her. If you have any questions, you can ask her. They just are starting a new book or started a new book or in the midst of starting next week. So if you're interested in that, get a hold of Christy. Also, we're having a concert here, not here, but in there, inside the church on Wednesday the 26th. Jamie Kimmett will be here. So if you would like to, we'd love to have you here. Enjoy the music. It's not like hard rock music or anything like that. It's pretty low-key, down-to-earth kind of stuff. So I think you'll enjoy it. Bring a friend, bring some folks, and hopefully we'll have a large group. We're kind of co-partnering this with Neshanic Church. So hopefully we'll have a nice event. And while you're here, and I think we're done with that, we do have, today is the 16th. And Jen's saying, don't tell him it's my birthday. So I'm going to respect Jen Boyd's wishes, and I'm not going to tell anyone that it's her birthday. It is, though. But today is hers. And then later, Levi Haig, Dan Morrison, Susan Simmons, and Don Hinkson, and Mary Titus, all before we meet again next week. So why don't we all just sing happy birthday, and instead of their names, God bless you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you. And I think that's it as far as announcements. And John Schneider.
Norm was saying that he and Sue are headed to Illinois tomorrow with a load of Bibles for Bill Rudge Ministries. I'm going to be using Psalm 84 as a basis for our prayer time this morning, if you'd like to take a look at that. One of the things that I mentioned in Sunday school when we opened with this is verse 3 says, the bird has found a house and the swallow a nest for herself where she may lay her young, even your altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and God. I take that to mean that, to hear those birds singing, this is the Lord's altar. Romans 1 tells us that we can learn about God from his creation. What we may know about him is evident in his creation, and he has made it plain. So if you join me in prayer, let's pray. Our Father, the psalmist says, and we agree with him, how lovely are your dwelling places, O Lord of hosts. May our soul long and yearn for your courts. Our heart and our flesh sing for joy to you. And we thank you as we hear the birds singing, being able to enjoy your creation this morning. We pray that you would open our eyes and our ears, our senses, to take in and understand what we may learn about you from your creation, your glory. Fathers, how many stars you've created, how awesome this universe is that you simply spoke into being. We pray that we might recognize that. Lord, we thank you that you bless those that dwell in you, and that we should ever praise you, that blessed is the man whose strength is in you, in whose heart are the highways to Zion. May we be like those that pass through a dry valley and make it a spring, that the early rain might bless it, that we would go from strength to strength, that we would appear before you in Zion. And Father, we thank you that through Jesus Christ, you have given us promises unto salvation and eternal life. Lord, we pray that you will hear our prayer, that you will give ear as we lift up these requests and praise to you today. May it be that in our hearts we will consider a day in your court better than 1,000 outside, and that being a servant in your house would be better than dwelling in the tents of the wicked. We pray that you would give us that kind of heart and bless us that trust in you. Father, we pray for our time together this morning, the singing, this time of prayer, the proclamation of your word, that these things would be pleasing to you, that they would bring glory to your name. Father, we pray for your church around this world, and in particular, we lift up new brothers and sisters in the country of Iraq that will suffer persecution from their Muslim family members. We pray that you'd give them courage and perseverance, Father, that they would grow in wisdom and knowledge of your word, and that they might present that word to their family members, their neighbors, friends, in grace, with grace and truth, just as Jesus came full of grace and truth. Father, I lift up the Willows Women's Center to you this morning. We thank you for that ministry, and thank you for the new home that they have just recently moved into, that they're hoping would make them more accessible, easier for the young women to get to, that they might expand their ministry. Lord, we thank you for the beautiful facility that they've been able to acquire and outfit. We pray that you would anoint that ministry and use it to reach out and provide life for the young children, for these babies that are in the womb and yet threatened there. Father, at the same time, we thank you for young ones, new children and grandchildren in our midst and in our families. We ask for your blessing on them and on their parents, on their grandparents as well. Father, we remember Robin as she's in the midst of delivery even now. We ask that you would be with her and deliver this child that might be healthy and well and be a blessing to its parents. And we just pray that they in turn would be given strength and wisdom to raise
him or her up, Lord, in your ways. Father, we do pray for our community, for our state, and for our country. We lift up our leaders to you. We remember them. Ask that you give them wisdom. Pray that you would bless them with humility, that they would understand and recognize that they serve in your stead, and that to be pleasing to you, they must follow your ways. We pray that you would guide them and lead them and bring them into this. We pray for our fellow citizens, that they would understand that we have a great privilege in this country, that we can have a say in who our leaders are. But with that comes a responsibility to understand that we must choose wisely and according to your guidance and your word, who we would set over us as our leaders. Father, we also pray along those lines that you would see fit to soften hearts and quicken minds to understand. Father, we pray for that around the world, but especially for those that we know, people that are dear to our hearts that you have brought into contact with our lives. They're precious to us, Father. And we pray that you would move in their hearts. Those that know you, that they would surrender more to you. Those that don't know you, that they would, their eyes would be open, Father. Remember them. Have mercy on them. We pray that the Spirit would bring conviction on their hearts about the truth of your word and that Jesus Christ is the Savior of this world. We lift these things up to you now and ask that you bless them, receive them as we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, this screen isn't easy to see. I wish I would have changed the color on it, and I'm too late to do that now.
That's okay, you may miss some stuff.
That's true. Yeah, you'd like that. All right, we'll go with this. Well, I was jogging this morning. I like to try to get a run in as many mornings as I can, and I learned that from my dad. And I was running this morning and thinking about different things in the service, and I knew Brad was going to be here today, and I remember a conversation that I'd had with Brad at some point. He had told me that his grandmother, now this is pretty impressive, his grandmother at 65 years old started walking 10 kilometers every single day. I was stunned. I'm like, that's just incredible. He said, yeah, she's 92 now and we have absolutely no idea where she's at. Another thought I had yesterday, said it's a shame nothing anymore is made in the USA. I bought a TV last night and it said built an antenna, and to be honest, I don't even know where that is. Well, this morning is the last sermon from our series related to our 30-day evangelism challenge. It's a text that is set within a story that most believers are probably well aware of, but also some of our non-believing friends. You may be familiar with this as well. Many of us have heard of the encounter that Jesus had with a man by the name of Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus was a tax collector. And being a wee little man, he climbed up in a tree to catch a glimpse of Jesus as he passed by. Zacchaeus likely wasn't expecting the events that transpired that day. But Jesus knew of his desire and his calls for him to come down from that tree, or he calls for him to come down from that tree. And during this divine encounter that Zacchaeus and Jesus have, Zacchaeus meets the Lord in salvation by coming to faith in Christ. Now, up until this moment, he'd only heard about Jesus. But following the encounter, he knows Jesus as his Lord and Savior. Now, I realize that we're outside and there are many trees all around us. With that being said, it's probably best for us not to climb any trees, Nathaniel, or take advantage of the opportunity like Zacchaeus did. But I, much like Jesus, am going to take this wonderful opportunity to share my faith in Christ by presenting the gospel to anyone here who hasn't yet heard. Like Zacchaeus, many have heard about Jesus, but they don't truly know him in a personal way. In fact, their knowledge of Jesus is oftentimes limited to what they've heard about what Christians believe. They may not admit it, but many really only consider the life of this man, Jesus, during Christmas and Easter, or perhaps at a funeral, or when they have run out of every other option and they decide to turn to him in prayer. In this one single verse, Jesus beautifully articulates his life and purpose for coming to earth. This morning, I want to examine the certainties that Jesus reveals in our text as we reflect on this wonderful passage. So if you do have your Bibles, you can open them to Luke chapter 19. And we'll take a little bit of time to consider the Savior. Luke chapter 19. It's okay. Luke 19, verse 10. For the Son of Man came to seek and save the lost. Now, just in case there was any doubt, Jesus affirms here that he was indeed the Christ, the promised Messiah. The Son of Man is a term that Jesus used often when referring to himself. It speaks of his humanity. He's declaring in this short passage to be God in the flesh. Now, during Christmas, we celebrate the birth of our Lord, or what we refer to as the incarnation, when Jesus, the sovereign Lord, laid aside his glory, when he came to earth robed in flesh, born of a virgin in a virgin womb. In his day, Jesus had his share of doubters, and those doubters remain still today. But his birth cannot be denied or disproven. Even those who don't believe that Jesus truly is God will admit that they know for sure that Jesus was an actual historical figure who absolutely, positively, definitely existed. He was an actual person. Now, here are just a few passages that speak to this divine truth. First, we have Luke chapter 2, verse 11. For unto you this day is for unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And then second, we have John 1:14. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. And third, we have Matthew 27, verse 54. When the centurion, now remind you, that this was during the crucifixion. Jesus had already been horribly misfigured. He had been mistreated. He had been abused. He was hardly recognizable as a human anymore. The centurions and the Romans were part of that group who made Jesus suffer. They were part of that group who really put it to Jesus, whipped him, insulted him. And here's what one of those centurions said. In Matthew 27, 54, when the centurion and those who were with him, keeping watch over Jesus, saw the earthquake and what took place, they were filled with awe and said, truly, this was the Son of God. This was a doubter among doubters. This was somebody who undoubtedly believed that Jesus was not the Messiah, that he was not a heavenly king, let alone an earthly king. And yet, through the resurrection, the experience that he witnessed firsthand, his claim was, truly, this was the Son of God. The life of Christ is also proven historically outside of the Bible as well. Many Jewish historians, such as Josephus and others, recorded the life and the death of Jesus Christ. I think it's fair to say that throughout history, Jesus is a central figure throughout all time and eternity. Never has a life so affected humanity as the life of Christ. For thousands of years, the Israelites looked forward to his coming. And now, some 2,000 years following his life and death, we still today preach, teach, and worship the name of Jesus. Jesus also affirms that he came to earth with a purpose. As you know, he preached the word with an authority that rivaled any teaching or any teacher they'd ever heard. He had power over nature, as we saw when he calmed the raging seas. He had power over humanity as he healed the sick and even raised the dead. These were all wonderful things. They all revealed that he was, in fact, the Christ. However, miracles weren't his purpose for coming. He came to seek and save the lost. There are countless accounts of the saving power of Christ, delivering those from the bondage of sin. In fact, many of us here today can attest to that. Jesus has always sought sinners out. He came to where they were in order to provide for their redemption. He sought out those who society had rejected and given up on. He sought the woman at the well, who'd have been ashamed to be seen in public. He sought the woman caught in adultery. He sought the lepers, the blind, the wounded, and the lame. He sought the hopeless and the lonely. He sought those who were steeped in religious tradition, those trusting in riches and positions of power, and even those who claimed loyalty to the Romans politically. Jesus came to those who stood in need of a Savior. Once again, he came to seek and to save. The word save in our passage has the idea of deliverance. They needed healing spiritually. They were undone before God. They needed to be made whole. Jesus came to provide all of that and more. He came to save. Now, I realize that there are many today who believe that God didn't come for people like them, that they're not good enough, or that they don't know enough, that they're beyond saving, that God could never save someone like them. But listen to what Jesus says in Luke chapter 5, verse 32. He says, "I have come to call the righteous, not the righteous, but sinners to repentance." And he says this in John 12, 27. "Now is my soul troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. But for this purpose, I have come to this hour." So for those of you questioning your worth before God, or that salvation and forgiveness in Christ is something that's only reserved for certain good people, understand that this passage that I just read, Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane. He knew that he would soon experience for the first time ever what it feels like, an experience that we feel daily, of what it feels like to be separated from God. And his soul was troubled. In fact, he had sweat that was like drops of blood. He knew that the sins of man and that the wages of sin, sins that he himself had never committed, but those sins will be placed on him. And he'll be lifted on the cross and die. And yet, that's why he came. He came to die for your sins and for mine. No one here this morning is beyond God's gracious act. And Zacchaeus recognized his need for Christ. And he looked to him for salvation. and everyone here can too. And let's just take a moment and just praise the Lord. Little Calvin was born at 11:08, 9 pounds, 13 ounces. So praise the Lord for that. That's great news. In spite of what you may have been told, Christ really did come to seek and save those who were lost. And every single person who is here was at least at one point lost. Some of you may still be lost. But the truth of the matter is that no one here is too lost for Christ to save them. Our modern culture may not understand the word or the truth it reveals, but that doesn't make it any less true. You see, due to the fall of Adam, who gave into temptation in the garden, sin entered the human race. And we all stand, each and every one of us, fallen in sin before God. Now, I realize that some of you have probably experienced so-called Christians who act as if they're better than you, as if they themselves deserve God's grace, but you don't. As if your sins deserve to be punished, but theirs deserve to be forgiven. As if God loves them, but hates you, or could never come to love you. But that's not what the scriptures teach. Romans 3:10 says, as it is written, none is righteous, no, not one. Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. In Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. I might as well throw in an Old Testament passage as well, Isaiah 53, verse 6. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned, every one, to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Now, so far we've considered the statement that Jesus made during his conversation with Zacchaeus thousands of years ago. But what does it all mean for us? How can we apply what Jesus said back then to our lives today? At the moment of this passage that we read, Calvary is a week or so away. In other words, Christ's death on the cross is about a week or so away. But Jesus will eventually go to the cross and bear our sin and endure the judgment that we deserve in order that we might be saved. He came to the earth as a man in order to offer himself the perfect atoning sacrifice for sin. And the reason is because we are all guilty and condemned by sin. We owed a debt to God that none of us could pay. We had no hope within ourselves of ever pardoning from sin and being reconciled to God. And so Jesus provided that which we never could. He died in our place, securing our salvation on the cross where he conquered death and hell before rising again 3 days later in triumphant resurrected life. For our justification. Because he lives, those who are saved by his grace have hope in the assurance of eternal life in him. Matthew chapter 1, verse 21. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. You see, just as Zacchaeus encountered Jesus and responded to his call, when we have an encounter with him, we too must respond in faith, believing that Jesus is the Christ. Through his death and resurrection, Jesus secured the means of salvation for all of humanity. But we must respond to his call to come to him in obedient faith for salvation. So if Jesus calls or convicts you to come to him, don't wait. Respond immediately. Now, I realize that we live in a time where everyone wants to be told how special they are. We want people to tell us that we should just be true to ourselves and that we can't let anybody or anyone tell us to be someone or something that we're not. But the truth is, we've got to see ourselves as lost and undone before God. We are desperately in need of cleansing from our sin. And trusting in his finished work. in the finished work of Christ by faith. It isn't enough to recognize that Jesus lived and died for the salvation of men. You've got to come to him by faith, with a repentant heart, believing in him for salvation. And understand that no one can do this for you. You and you alone are responsible for your salvation in Christ. Now, we use words like repent, and oftentimes people just aren't sure what that means. To repent is to change your mind about God and about one's spiritual condition and about what it takes to come into a right relationship with God. Repentance is a change of mind that results in a life change, a change of actions. In other words, I say this often, but if you were a gossip and you come to faith in Christ and you repent of being a gossip, you cannot continue to just gossip and gossip and gossip. If you are a liar, a cheater, a thief, if you're living in sexual immorality, you can't continue to live in sexual immorality. You can't continue to be a liar, a thief, and expect that God is going to bless you. To repent is to recognize that that is sin, to recognize that that is in opposition to God's holy calling. And we must turn from that. And we don't just turn from that, we turn to a holy and righteous God. See, we have to come to a recognition that God's standard is perfect righteousness, and we are perfectly unrighteous. We can no longer live according to the desires of our sinful flesh, but we must now turn and live by the desires and the will of God. If God calls it a sin, it's a sin. You see, God is ruler and God sets the rules. Therefore, if you're a gossip, repent means you no longer gossip. If you're a thief, you no longer steal. If you're a liar, you no longer lie. If you're full of lust, you must cease those sinful desires. If you're living in sexual immorality, you now turn to sexual purity according to scriptures. Now, I know that turning away from sin and toward God isn't as easy as it sounds, but it is necessary. And I can tell you that it's more than worth it. John 3:16-18. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only Son of God. Understand that how we live and respond to life demonstrates what we truly believe. If we believe that God's word is true, if we believe what his word says, that if you love me, you will obey my commands, then as difficult as it might be, we learn to obey his commands. We don't change them to suit our own sinful desires. In our text, Jesus declares that he's come to seek and to save that which was lost. He came to redeem sinners from sin, to pay the debt they owed, and to provide restoration to God the Father. You see, Zacchaeus stood in need of salvation. And in verse 9, if you look back at that, Jesus declared, today, salvation has come to this house. You see, there is great hope and comfort in the words of Jesus. He came to seek and save those who were lost in sin. He didn't set limits on whom salvation would be offered to and whom it wouldn't. He came to seek and save all who are lost. I'm thankful that Jesus didn't set a list of prerequisites for salvation, because I know I wouldn't qualify. I'm just a bum from Sharon, saved by the grace of God. I want you to know beyond a shadow of a doubt that Jesus came to save us from our sin, and that he's able and willing to save each and every one of us if we will respond to him in faith. There is no one here who is so wicked that God cannot save. If you're here today and you have yet to receive Christ as your Savior, I want you to know that there is still hope for you. He came for you. He died for your sins, purchasing your redemption. Salvation is available to you today if you will respond to him by faith. I, for one, am thankful that Jesus was willing to come for our salvation. I'm glad that he came to seek and save the lost, of which I was. I'm thankful that he bore our sins on the cross, fully satisfying the righteous demands of God the Father, that he took our place and died for us, and that he rose again triumphant, providing eternal life for all who believe. Do you know Christ as your personal Savior? I hope you see him as more than a babe in the manger, but also as a Savior and Lord. If you've yet to respond to the call of salvation, I ask you to come to him today. He wants to save you. Simply come to him by faith. Repent and believe. If you've yet to respond to the call of salvation, come to him. He wants to save you. For those who are already saved, I pray that you are reminded of all that you've received in Christ. I hope this has been a stirring reminder that will challenge you to proclaim the gospel to the lost and a dying world. Many today stand in need of salvation. They just need someone to share the gospel with them. I pray that this series has been beneficial, and that we are all at least a little more committed to reaching the lost for Christ. As I said last week, the challenge is in your hands. So how will you respond? You might be sitting here today and you say, well, we're Christians. Why is he sharing us the gospel? Well, how many times do you need to hear it before you share it with someone else? The greatest gift we can ever give, the greatest boldness we can ever demonstrate, is sharing Christ with others, knowing that we have a power that we receive through the Holy Spirit. And I pray that if you are convicted today, if you say, you know what, I've been living a lie. I've really never surrendered my life to Christ. I know what he did for me, and I'm glad that he died for me. The truth is, I've not yet been willing to live for him. Well, today is our day of reckoning. Today should be our day that we decide firmly in our hearts that now is the day that I will start to live for Christ. We've been taught over the last several weeks that we are to follow, or actually the last couple months, to follow God's example. And Christ's example was to seek and save the lost. We ought to do the same thing. Let's get out of our bubble. Let's begin to seek and save the lost. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we do thank you once again for this day. We thank you for the opportunity to gather together in your house. Brothers and sisters in Christ, come to worship and adore your holy name. Lord, we thank you. Lord, every one single person here was once lost. But Lord, many have been found. We thank you, Lord, that you didn't leave us in our sinful, dreadful estate. Lord, that you didn't leave us to be held accountable one day to God the Father, the judge. But you've redeemed us. Lord, you've rescued us. You've saved us. Lord, I pray that you will convict and touch everyone's heart, Lord. And if there is anyone who here today wants to learn more about what it means to receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, I pray, Lord, that they will speak to myself or one of our elders or leaders, that they might be led into a saving relationship with Christ, and that they might join this body of fellowship to grow and mature in their faith. Lord, thank you for all that you've done. We ask that you continue to embolden us. Lord, keep us encouraged. And Lord, keep us focused as we go about our daily lives. Lord, may we not live for our own pleasures and glory, but may we live for the glory and according to the will of the Father. In Jesus' name, amen. If you will you please stand and join us in singing Draw Me Close.
Thank you.
do want to thank you all for joining us, and just want to say you're all welcome to stay around and enjoy some a light lunch with us and just hang out for a little bit. There are tables up there, of course, and if you want to sit in your chair, and if anybody does want us to set up some tables, let us know, and Bev will do that for us. Appreciate that. But I'm sure that we can get those things set up. So just trying to see who's going to pray for our meal. Does anybody want to pray for the meal? All right, I'll talk to God. Let's pray. Father, we do thank you for this opportunity to gather together. We thank you for just a beautiful day. Thank you for allowing us to get outside and be in your creation. And Lord, what a wonderful property we have here. And we just thank you for the sound of the birds and critters running around. Lord, we are just blessed. And Lord, as we stick around for a little time of fellowship, and Lord, we break bread with one another. Lord, we ask that you would bless our conversations and our time together. Lord, may all that we say and do bring you glory and honor. Lord, we do pray that you will be pleased with our fellowship. And we just thank you. We ask that you would bless the food and the nourishment of our bodies and us to your service. And now receive the benediction. Peace be to the brothers, and love with faith from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace be with all who love our Lord Jesus Christ with love incorruptible. Make it a great week. Thank you.